Hi, welcome to this talk. It's called Primary on Recommendation Systems. A little bit about me. I'm Manuel. I'm right now a freelance data scientist. I was born in Portugal. I've been living in Spain most of my life, and I spent the last 4 years in New York. Now I'm back here in Murcia, as you probably know if you saw the lightning talk yesterday. In terms of career path, I started as a consultant in Madrid. Then I moved to a data analyst position, and then I moved to a data scientist position. That basically means I followed a very common path in terms of knowledge and tools, right? I started with Excel, like pushing the limits of Excel, writing VBA macros, hating myself. Then I discovered R, and I was mind blown to how easy was the figure of data frame and how much stuff you could do with it. Then for some reason, R didn't scale, so I moved to Python, and I was mind blown again. And lately I've been working with a lot of like very big data sets, so I'm using mostly Spark. That's my website, and you should go there for two reasons. First, if you go there, you can see a picture of my dog, who is very cute. Second, if you go to that website /PyConES, you get to see the slides of the talk. There is way more content on the slides than what I'm gonna talk. Actually, I should put the timer, right? Because I don't see any timer here. So give me 1 second, I'm gonna put the timer. Okay, cool. Well, that's my personal email and my Twitter handle. And in one of my clients, we are looking for a Django developer. So if you're looking for working on a very good project, you can send an email to my email, manuel@trevclick, or to hiring@trevclick.com. A little bit about this talk, it's entry level. That means if you know a lot about recommendation systems, there is a slight chance that you will learn nothing. And it's also a very practical talk. There are lots of examples. That means if you have installed Pandas, NumPy, and SciPy, then you can clone the repository, and then you can follow along the examples. Is anyone interested in following along? If not, you can do it at home, at your will. Anyone? No? Okay. That way I can go faster. I don't need to wait. What are recommendation systems? As per the Wikipedia, recommendation systems are a subclass of information filtering that seek to predict a rating that a user would give to an item. I really don't like that definition. I think it's too convoluted. For me, a recommendation system is basically a system that provides recommendations, which I think everyone understands, and it's much simpler. So these are systems that provide recommendations, but how do they provide those recommendations, right? They need information. And for that, there are many sources of information. One of the most common ones, of course, is the actual item information. For example, if you are recommending shoes, is the shoe red? Is it blue? Is it a sneaker? Or is it a healthy shoe? Then you also have information about the actual user. Where are they located? That would be characteristics about the user. You also have information about their explicit requirements. Have the user told us, no, I only like sneakers, for example. You have also information about how the user interacts with your site, right? Which kind of shoes is the user browsing? And then you have platform information, which is basically information relevant to your specific problem, normally to your specific business. For example, when you are recommending items at Amazon, maybe we want to push a little bit items that are on sale. Or if you are selling perishable items, maybe it makes sense to recommend items that are about to expire. Those are all sources of information that you can taper on and that you should really use for your recommendation system. This is a short note on similarity because everyone talks about similarity, but not many people explain what similarity is. I'm sure you understand the concept of similarity, but in data science, there are many different measures on similarity, and some of them can be applied to different problems. For example, if you are measuring similarity between strings, between text, a very common and basic measure would be the Livingstein or, well, Jarrow-Winkler, you have multiple versions. It's basically called the edit distance. That basically means how many changes we need to do to a string A so it becomes B. For example, to change rig into arc, you need to change to do 3 changes. Another interesting similarity measure that we will use is the Jacquard index. And this one is very useful when you are measuring similarity among sets. It's basically measured as the intersection of users into sets divided by the union. For example, if you're measuring how similar two groups of friends are, their Jacquard index would be the number of friends in both groups divided by the number of friends that are in either one of the groups. It has a value between 0 and 1, of course. Then you have more commonly used measures like distances. One is the Manhattan distance, which measures the distance between two points in basically right angles. Then you have the Euclidean distance, which is basically the geometric distance, as the formula, the pure geometric formula. And then you have cosine similarity, which basically measures the cosine of the angle between two vectors. There are many more similarity metrics, and you can check that out online. So what are the main approaches to recommendation systems? There are many other, but the most common ones could be content filtering, collaborative filtering, hybrid systems, and then you have the other, because on any list, you always need to have another at the bottom. I'm going to talk mainly about the first two, but first, let's talk about the other. For example, you have demographic recommendations. Let's imagine that you are very, very lucky, and in your company, you have demographic information about your user. That almost never happened, but who knows? In that case, you can just categorize all your users into different strata, demographic strata, gender, age, et cetera, and then you can use any kind of research on the matter. You can even do some panels to recommend items to those strata. Another example of recommendations, which is very simple, is social recommendations. We do that all the time. Anytime you're clicking that share button on Android that does this, right? You're like sharing something with someone, you're doing an explicit act of social recommendation. Okay, let's talk about content filtering. In content filtering, the main source of information, it's the items themselves. That means that in content filtering, all the items are mapped into a feature space based on their characteristics, and we use those features to recommend. So that means that we're getting all the information from the items themselves. That doesn't mean that we don't use the information about the user to recommend. It's just that we use that information only when we're recommending, but not when we are computing the features. A very popular example of content filtering would be Pandora, which you might not know because it's blocked here, but it's probably the main online radio in the US. And it's very simple. It has a very nice interface. When you log in for the first time, it tells you, hey, I don't know who you are, but you can enter an artist, song, or a genre, and you can create your own station. So you just put something there, and for example, if I put Blind Guardian, for example, it will start playing power metal music. The cool thing about this is I can add more artists or songs, and it will learn about my tastes more and more and give me more accurate recommendations. So how does Pandora work? Pandora is based on the Music Genome Project, which is a project that aims to be the most in-depth taxonomy of music. On this project, every song is mapped on a set of more than 450 features. That means Pandora has a team of musical analysts. Those are experts in music. And they categorize every month 10,000 new songs that they receive, and they map them into that set of features. These are some examples of the features on the left. For example, you have abstract lyrics, right? You have use of dirty sounding organs. Those are features that might make sense to us, but if you're a musical expert, those probably make more sense to you. So pros and cons of content filtering. The pros are very simple. Given that you are only using information about the item to recommend, when you get a new user, you can just ask them, hey, I don't know you, tell me which song you like, and I can start recommending right away. It's very easy. Another very important pro is that you can apply domain knowledge. Pandora has a set of musical analysts who are experts in music, and it can use that knowledge to provide better recommendations. A very big con is that you need to map every single item into all the features. For example, let's say that tomorrow Pandora receives a new song that has a very unique style, so it doesn't fit on any of those 450 features. So Pandora decides, oh, let's add a new feature. That means they have to map like all their million of songs into that new feature. Another con that it has is since you are hard coding the features by yourself, the recommendations are very limited in scope. Pandora uses 450 features, but how do we know that the number of features that you should use to recommend music are 1,000? We don't know. We are just doing humanly interpretable features for this. What I'm going to do now, the first example, and you know, everything is on the repository, so you get the slides, you can clone this, and you have all the data to do these systems at home. We're going to use the MovieLens dataset. It's a dataset released by the University of Chicago, and basically it has two main tables. One table that has movie information, the movie and the genres, for example, and then you have a ratings table. That table has user ratings. So here we get into like the Panda Zone. Basically we are, I can't really see. So basically we are loading the movies table because in this case we're gonna do content filtering. So we don't need the ratings. We're just gonna use the features of the movies. Basically we are creating a set of dummy variables you see on the right. For each movie, we're basically using a set of zeros and ones, with ones being a category that the movie is. For example, Toy Story, we'll have on the animation column a one, on the children's column a one, and on the comedy column a one, and everything else will be zeros. This is a very simple model, by the way. So for example, let's say we get a new user, right? We ask him, hey, I don't know you. Tell me some movies that you like. Let's assume that this guy really likes action movies and adventure, and some sci-fi, and some animation and children's movies, for example, right? That information is all we need to recommend new items to him. How do we do that, right? We have that user movies. So what we can do is we can get from all the movies on the table, we can just get the slice of those movies that the user has told us, right? That gives us a vector of zeros and ones. We then transpose that. So we get the movies as rows and the categories. And then we do the average. That gives us a vector, which for this user would be 0.666, 0.333, et cetera. That would be the feature, the user specifications feature for this specific user. So with that information, we can basically calculate the recommendation, the prediction for this user for a movie. We have the user preferences, and we have the movie categories, so we can do just a dot product, and then you get a number. That number gives you how similar that movie is compared to the user specifications. Some examples. Given that this guy liked adventure, and action, and sci-fi, he gets a higher score for Terminator 2 than for Scream, because he didn't tell us, he didn't like almost any horror movie. For example, these numbers in this case have no meaning, but when you are sorting, you know which movies are more likely the user to like than the others. So now that we have this formula, this function that gets predicted movie score, it's very easy. We can just, for each movie on the table, we can just use that formula and we get a predicted score for that user. Then we just sort by that score and we return the top K. For example, here we're returning, I think, the top 10, for example, right? So given that user liked action and adventure and some children, well, you get similar movies. He likes some Star Wars, so he gets some Star Wars, he gets Transformers. This is not evaluating the quality of the movie. This is just based on the categories. Okay, cool thing is, let's say we don't want to ask for movies. We can just ask him, oh, give us explicitly your preferences. You give them the user a set of sliders, drag your preference in terms of categories, and in this case, it's the same thing as before. The user is giving us explicitly his feature list. So we can do the same. In this case, we have the user that likes action, adventure, fantasy, and sci-fi a lot, and he hates film noir, whatever, and drama, and documentaries. So with that vector, we can do the same, and we get similar recommendations. Now, a short note on how to evaluate your recommender system. You have recommendation systems. It looks like it works, but how do you measure when you are implementing another model to compare versus the other? This is very hard to judge by a human. There are different approaches to recommendation systems. One common approach is to see recommendation system as a classification. This is also called the recommend some good items. I'm just gonna give a user some items that the user might or might not like. For example, when you are reading an online newspaper, at the bottom you see articles you might like. Probably the newspaper doesn't care which one do you click on. So in these cases, you can use any measure that you could use with any classification problem. One common one is just the precision, which basically is the true positives divided by the sum of the true positives and the false positives. That basically means, of the items I recommended, which ones did the user actually like? Very simple. You can use other formulas like AUC or F1 score. For example, I mean, there are multiple. I like precision for these specific cases. There is another approach, which is recommendation as a ranking. That means giving a user some items, recommend me a list of items in ranking order, with the first one being the most likely and the bottom one being the least likely. For example, Netflix uses scores. You can put like 1 to 5 stars. So when Netflix is doing recommendation, Netflix predicts a score. So in this case, given that you have a predicted score and an observed score, you can just use something like root mean square error. Or another common measure is normalized discretized cumulative gain, which sounds pretty complicated, but if you check the slides, I explain all the formula in detail there. I'm not gonna explain it here. And that's a very good paper on evaluation for recommendation systems if you wanna check it out. This is just an example I did, very simple. You get a set of user movies and a set of user recommendations, and basically I'm just calculating the true positive, false positive, false negative, and then I calculate the precision, I calculate the recall, and the F1 score, which is just the harmonic mean of the precision and recall. And then I just return it. So if we have the user that we saw before, the user told us he liked the movies on the top, and we recommended those movies, you see that the prediction is, the precision is terrible. This is a very simple model, but also you shouldn't expect the same level of precision in these problems that with any regular classification problem, just so you know. Okay, let's continue to collaborative filtering. This is, that's a link to the original paper. It's from 1998, but I think it's still much newer than content filtering. Content filtering, I think it's much older. So in collaborative filtering, what you are using to calculate the item features is the interaction that users do with items. This is based on the assumption that similar users will like similar items. So the cool thing about this is now we don't have to map things manually. Now we have all this huge set of data, which is just the user interactions to recommend with. So this is very good. There are two basic approaches, item-based, in which what you do is you compute similarity between items based on the user interactions, and then you recommend items based on other items. But then you also have the user item, in which you calculate the similarity between users, then given a user, you find similar users, and then you recommend other items that that user might like. That you can see that online when you see users like you also liked X. That would be a user item collaborative filtering example. A very common example of this would be Amazon of a few years ago. I think now they use a completely different algorithm. Basically, when you go to Amazon, you see, oh, customers who bought this item also bought X, right? And that's the definition that Amazon did in pseudocode for their algorithm. So basically, for every item on all their catalog, then they go for every user that bought that, then they go for every other item that is not that one that that user bought, then you just record that, that there was a joint purchase of those two items. So that gives you a huge matrix of item to item, and then you can compute something like causing similarity to get similarity among items. A case of user item collaborative filtering, even though Facebook uses a graph-based approach, it's some kind of user item collaborative filtering. For example, when you go to the people you may know, you see some people, right? So how does Facebook do it? Basically, they go to your friends, and they go to your friends' friends that aren't your friends, and it recommends them as friends. That makes sense, right? Okay, so pros of collaborative filtering, a very good one, you can recommend new items without having to actually having a human or an expert categorize them. That's very good. That's related to domain agnostic, right? You're just using user interaction to recommend, so you don't need to be an expert on anything. This kind of system can be plugged into basically any system, whether you're recommending movies or shoes. It doesn't care about the item themselves. The cool thing also is that it can recommend based on hidden features that a human, even a musical expert, would recognize. For example, if you are recommending movies, it can probably find some weird vector combination of some actors or some kind of scenes that appear in a movie, because that's how the users are interacting with the movies themselves. A big problem is it's called the cold start problem. Basically, until you get some information about the user, about how the user is interacting with your site, you don't know what to recommend, right? You have no information about the user in this case. Another problem is that every time a user interacts with something, you need to recompute all the features because every interaction affects the actual similarities. Okay, we're gonna do another exercise, which basically we're gonna do a collaborative filtering on Reddit. I guess all of you know what Reddit is. Yes? I guess I'm gonna assume that you know what Reddit is. It's like Meneame but better. So this was a pet project of mine. You go to that website, you can go there, you can use OAuth on Reddit to give permissions for an hour to get the subreddits you are subscribed to, and it will recommend some new subreddits. So basically what I did is I downloaded like almost 2 million messages for the top 10,000 subreddits, and I used Jacquard similarity index to find the similarity between subreddits. So basically here, in this problem, we want to recommend new subreddits to a user given the subreddits he or she is subscribed to. So this repository has a SQLite database that has all the popularity data. Basically it has two tables. One table has the redditors table, which basically has two columns. So it has the redditor and the subreddit that redditor wrote to. For example, tweet08 wrote to memes and to portal, for example. I think there, 1,750,000 comments. So basically this is how a very simple way of how you could compute the similarity between two subreddits. Basically you need to do two SQL queries. On the first one, you're getting the union of sub one and sub two, which is basically give me all the users that have commented either on sub one or on sub two. That would be the union. And then the intersection is give me those users that have written to sub one and sub two. Then if there is some intersection, you just return the intersection divided by the union. If the intersection is zero, if the union is zero, you just return zero. So for example, if we apply this to aviation and flying, you get 0.1. 0.1 doesn't make sense by itself. Remember, Jacquard goes between 0 and 1. I didn't track the whole Reddit. I just used a very small sample. So this is a way of how you could brute force and compute all the similarities. Don't do this. This takes like days. Basically, I have like a list of the subreddits, so you can get all the combinations, and then you can call that function that I mentioned before. And that way, you start calculating the similarities between subreddits. The cool thing about this is I populated the similarity table for you, so you can get very easily the most similar subreddits, right? You're just sorting by that Jacquard index, which makes a lot of sense, right? You are getting that keto, which is a kind of recipes, is very similar to keto recipes. You have that aviation and flying is very similar. That ask transgender is a very similar community to transgender. This makes a lot of sense. And if you have more data, of course, those indexes will go higher. So now we have the similarity pre-computed. Now you get a new user. How do you recommend to the user? Very simple. You just get, on the top one, utility function. So you get the subreddits that the user has commented to, or you can use on my website, I use OAuth to just get permissions to get all the subreddits you are subscribed to. And basically what you're doing is just summing the similarities for all the table when either one of the subreddits is on that list. Basically what you're doing is for each subreddit that the user subscribed, you're getting the similarities with the rest, and you're just summing up. At the end, you just get a list of sum of Jacquard indexes, which then of course you do the same thing. You sort by and you return the top K. So we have this random user that I don't know, but I really like him because he is really into, if you check that, he's really into politics, right? As politics, moderate politics. He's also somehow interested in technical things like command line, hackers. He likes some religious things like atheism, change my view stuff. So when you recommend to him, what do you get? Well, you get a lot of liberal subreddits because he's interested in politics, he's interested in technology. And he's turned into religion. So it makes sense that he gets some liberal, he gets to restore the fourth, libertarian, politic, etc. Those are subreddits that the user might not be aware of, and that based on these, he would probably like. Another example. In this case, we're going to do collaborative filtering, and we're going to use the same movie lens dataset that we used before. But in this case, we're doing collaborative filtering. That means we're going to use the ratings that the users are giving to movies. So we're using the interactions to build the similarities between movies. Basically, we're loading the ratings table. We're removing the timestamp column. We're merging with the movies, so we have the title. The original table only has the user ID, the movie ID, and the rating. But for legibility, it makes sense to have the movie title. I think this is a pretty big, I think I used the a million or something ratings. Okay, so what are we doing here? Basically, we are turning that table, which remember is like a long table, it's not wide, into a matrix. Into a matrix with rows being the users and columns being the movies. And on each intersection, the rating that a user has given to a movie. The problem with this is this table is extremely sparse. Remember, if there are 3,700 movies and a user has given ratings to what? 10 movies? That means that 3,690 values on that row will be nulls, right? So we need to perform some data imputation so you don't get everything null. A very example way is what we can do here. This is a very common approach, by the way. What you can do is for every movie, you remove the nulls by the average rating for that movie. And then, and this is very important, for every user, you need to deduct the mean of that user, the mean rating given by that user. And that is done, why? To remove the user bias, because in this case, we're comparing users that give fives to every single movie, because they really love movies. But then you have also users that are giving ones to every movie, because they hate movies. So you remove that user bias by deducting his mean rating. Okay, so we have this matrix. Now, what do we do? Well, to measure the similarity between those movies, we are going to use the Pearson product moment correlation coefficient, which if you check on Wikipedia, the formula is surprisingly easy. It's just the covariance divided by the multiplication of the standard deviations. Basically, this has a value between -1 and 1. -1 happens when two vectors are completely inversely correlated. 0 is when they are not correlated at all. And 1 is when they are highly correlated, right? Of course, we want to return those with the higher Pearson product moment coefficient. To compute this, we're just going to get that matrix that we had with users and items, and we're going to apply the formula NumPy CorcoF. If you realize, you'll see that I'm transposing the matrix, because remember, in this case, the rows are the users, and if we compute a similarity like that, how the CorcoF works, we would be computing similarity among users. And then we will have a user item similarity, collaborative filtering, but we're doing item to item, so we just transpose it, and then we are, with the same formula, we are computing similarity among movies. And there are 3,700 movies. So now this is pretty cool, because now, given a movie, we can get all the similar movies to that one, because now you just have a set of movies as rows and movies and columns, and the intersection is just their Pearson coefficient. So given a specific movie, for example, Star Wars 4, you can get the most similar movies just by getting that row and selecting those movies with a threshold value over, in this case, I'm using 0.2, because that's what works in this data set. Different data sets will require different threshold. For example, with Die Hard, when you filter and you get similar movies, what do you get? Well, you get Die Hard, because similarity between the same movie will be 1. Then you get Die Hard 2, Die Hard 3, Lethal Weapon, to get very similar movies. So now we have a way of measuring similarity among movies. How do we recommend to a user? Well, same way as before. For a given user, you just get those movies that the user has given ratings to. And then what we're going to do is we're basically going to, for every movie that the user has given ratings, we're just going to get the similarity vector with the rest, and we're just going to sum. Same thing that we did with subreddit with a different metric. After that, we just sort by that score, and we return top K. For example, here we have this not-so-random user, because I really love that user, because that user is probably like a father or something, because he's just rating like kids' movies and stuff, and I'm sure it's not a kid, like just rating, oh, I love, you know, like, I don't know, Iron Giant, for example, I don't know, even though that's an awesome movie. So basically, this guy really likes like children, animation, some adventure stuff. So given that information, we can just use this model, and what do we do? What do we get? We basically get the whole Disney catalog, because that's what he liked, right? So that kind of makes sense. Okay, we're going to talk about hybrid systems. And hybrid systems are basically a combination, and they try to remove the problems of those two methods. Remember, in the collaborative filtering, we have the cold start problem, which means until I have information about you, I cannot recommend. And on the content filtering, the big problem is I can only recommend based on certain features, and I need to map every item into those new features. So what do? We combine both. First thing we do is when someone comes and someone is new and I have no idea about him, we use content filtering. And then once I get to know you better, then I can use collaborative filtering or a weighted model that uses the combination of both outputs. A classic example, Netflix. Netflix, you can see, oh, here are your top picks for Manu, right? Well, that's me. Basically, that is based on how you're interacting with Netflix. But you can also say, oh, I want to see very similar items to this. And that's giving you some categories based on the features in that movie. So here, there is a combination of those two ways implemented into the same model. OK, a little bit about libraries and stuff. Libraries in Python, those are four. What I like a lot is Crab and Python Rexis. LightDFM is pretty awesome. It uses a hybrid model that allows you to use on the same model both item metadata and collaborative metadata. That means you can recommend you remove the cold start problem. That one is very good. 15 seconds, okay. In terms of big data, I would use Apache Spark. It has a lot of collaborative filtering plugins there. Apache Mahout, it's good. The rest I haven't used. And it's 2016, so we have to talk about TensorFlow, right? Now YouTube, Google has switched all their models into, well, most of the recommendations into TensorFlow. So those are the 2 and 3, the links 2nd and 3rd are the papers, the links to the papers of how Google uses TensorFlow to provide recommendations in YouTube and in Google Play. So this is all, but if you go, I don't have time, but you can check another bonus exercise if you download the slides. This one is pretty cool. Thank you. You have any questions? And that's my dog. Any questions? Oh, I know it's like nap time, so people are kind of like, this might have been too heavy for this time. I apologize. So, no questions? One question. I don't hear anything, man, sorry.
In content filter mechanisms, if the user likes, for example, action and terror movies, but they don't like action terror movies, that can be a problem.
Well, what you can do is then use the geometric features, right? You use a feature called action, you use a feature called horror, and you use a feature called action and horror.
But you have to know the features in advance.
Well, yeah, this is like a 2 example, but that you would know in advance, right? But you have that problem, right? If it's not just, I hate action plus horror. No, I hate action plus horror, but scary movies. Like those that they have, like you open the door, right? That's hard to codify as a human feature. That's one of the problems of content filtering. No more questions? Okay. Up. Okay. That is called implicit data, and that's also used in other recommendation systems. What implicit data means is, oh, it's not only the movies that you have watched, it's also the movies that you haven't watched, right? There are different approaches that also make use of the implicit data that you're giving as a user to recommend.
So, don't watching a type of film, it doesn't imply that I don't like that type.
No, it doesn't mean, but we are more sure that you don't like something that you haven't watched than something that you have watched and you have given a 5, for example. In this case, you could also apply, there is no reason to use a scale of 1 to 5. You could use -5 if you absolutely hate something.
In the content-based filtering, in the music example, mm-hmm.
I have no idea.
You
would need to be an expert for that. The thing is, I have no insights about how they are actually mapping the features, if they are using some kind of a score. I wouldn't be surprised if, given that these people are non-technical experts, they probably assign some kind of manual score to them. Probably, and then they might be doing some kind of causing similarity or any other measure I wouldn't be surprised. I don't know, but you know, unless they are technical. If they are technical, they can do something else. But technical plus expert in music, it's kind of like hard folk to find, I'd say. It was. Well, what Netflix does is they give you multiple accounts. In my case, I have mine and my wife. We're only paying for one, but I know what you're saying. Ideally, you would either specify a user, right, and put it into the function. So then you're just splitting the data into both users, right? If you have no user information, then from the point of view of the recommendation, it's hard to tell whether it's you or your girlfriend. No, these are examples. You know what I mean? Like, you wanted to build a production-ready recommendation system. Either you build something much harder, or you just use Spark Collaborative Filter. You wanted to do a production big data scale system. You can do it on your own, but you know, why reinventing the wheel?
Oh.
Yeah, well, I mean, not only changes with your mood, it also changes with time, right? Like, I don't like the same songs now that I liked 10 years ago. Yeah, that's a harder problem in which, you know, probably you don't only use one song, you use like an array of songs to recommend a new song. So you have been listening to like more depressing songs, and there are more chances that you would like another one for a rainy mood day, for example. That's one of the reasons why Google uses deep and wide neural networks for recommending, because you get the generalization of regression, but also the neural information of a deep neural network. Any other question? No? Okay, well, thanks, guys.